Sir, that PCL thing, what should we do, sir?
The PCL, as I told you the other day, I have shared the content, the standard brochure in the WhatsApp group. You should create content chapters. We should create chapters according to the format given as a group. Okay, and I think by today you should have submitted all the three chapters. And this sixth, I have mentioned the deadline, right? To
yes,
submit
sir.
The reports.
What time is 5B? Because we'll have Toastmasters next week.
No, they will manage accordingly. For one set of sections we'll have in the morning, other set post lunch. Okay, yours will be combined with E section. Your presentations will be combined with E section, and there is Viva is for 40 marks. We should take it seriously. Okay, and the same marks that you get for 40, the same marks will be reduced to 10 for Avishkar. So this actually it's for 50 marks. Got it? This Viva, take it seriously. See to it that all of you participate actively. And if anybody does not participate in your group, don't worry. You just let me know who has not participated, and that person will not get marks.
So the Viva will be individual or group? Like
it's a group presentation. PCL is a group activity, right?
Yeah. I mean, the Viva, will they ask questions individually or in a group?
No. Let's say when your group is presenting, they will ask the question to the group, or they may ask the question to one of the group members. So all of you should be aware of it.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So Toastmasters, what should we do, sir?
So we need to present the chapters.
Yes, they will ask you to, each one of you. See, in presentation, you should just mention the highlights of the three chapters that you have all, that you would have uploaded in the Google Classroom. Got it? And then this PCL, they have sent a separate link, right, for you people to upload. The other day, I shared it to you.
So what is that, sir? What
so PCL, you have to upload topics, three chapters. Okay, and in the Viva, you should go through the links, go through emails related to PCL, go through WhatsApp, this one, go through Google Classroom assignments related to PCL. What it? There are three chapters. You have to upload the content for all those three chapters. Okay. And 6th of December, not 6th, 9th, you will have your Viva. Okay, 9th, you should present your PCL topics as a group. You should be thorough about your presentations. They can ask questions to any one of you. So it's for totally 50 marks, including Avishkar. So the marks that you get in Viva, that will be reduced to this thing, Avishkar, for 10 marks. Anything else, any doubts?
So Viva will be related to PCL.
Yes. Viva will be related to PCL because it is PCL Viva only.
So Toastmasters, what should we do, sir?
Toastmasters, you will be giving your speeches, right? Once you deliver sir. Your speech, the Toastmaster in charge would have given you some assessment sheets. That sheets you have to upload.
Okay, sir. Okay.
That sheets you have to upload. Again, in the Google Classroom. Okay, because by 10th, you have to finalize, you have to complete all the pending assignments because we'll be updating IA marks.
Sir, what about the people who haven't given this speech? Because there are quite a few, sir, so we need...
You check with your mentors. Ask them what will they do.
Sir, do we have time till the end of November, till the end of December for giving
us... No. We don't have time. 10th, we have to finalize everything and... update the internal assessment marks to the university. You check with your Toastmasters mentors, ask them, this is what the teachers are telling, what are we supposed to do?
Okay.
Okay, then let's start with the next topic, Girls at War by Chinua Achebe. Chinua Achebe, as you all know, is an African writer. His main work or prominent work or famous work is Things Fall Apart. Most of his works mainly deal with the conflicts that an African person faces because of the existence of both the Western culture and also the African culture. Okay, the dilemma that any African person faces is, should the person follow the African culture, which his ancestors followed, or the alien Western culture? Okay, the first time their paths crossed, nothing happened. That was in the first heady days of warlike preparation, when thousands of young men and sometimes women too were daily turned away from enlistment centers because far too many of them were coming forward, burning with readiness to bear arms in the defense of the exciting new nation. So here Chinu Achebe talks about the probable conflict situation that exists in that existed in most of the African countries during the colonial period. Okay, he says he's talking about meeting of two people. So when these two people met for the first time, there was nothing much happened. The second time they met was at a checkpoint at Aka. Then the war had started and was slowly moving southwards from the distant northern sector. He was driving from Onitsha to Enugu and was in a hurry. All the intellectually approved of thorough searches at roadblocks, emotionally was always offended whenever he had to submit to them. So he is talking about how there are talking about the absurdity of the security checks, okay, in his own nation. He would probably not admit it, but the feeling people got was that if you are put through a search, then you could not really be one of the big people. So this is the perception in today also. Okay, only if you are a VIP, you are exempted from the security checks. If you are an ordinary person, in every stages of the security post, you will be checked. Generally, he got away without a search by pronouncing in his deep authoritative voice, Reginald Wanko, Minister of Justice. So he was working under this ministry. He was a senior most bureaucrat there. Therefore, he used to reveal his identity by showing his ID card and used to escape the checks. That almost always did. But sometimes either through ignorance or sheer cussedness, the crowd and the odd checkpoint would refuse to be impressed. As happened now at Aka, two constables carrying heavy Mark IV rifles were watching distantly from the roadside, leaving the actual searching to local vigilance. So Mark IV rifles here refers to type of rifle similar to AK-47 and those kinds. So here are times, many a times he had escaped any kind of security check because of his identity. But unfortunately in Aka, those who were in charge of checking or doing the security, they had delegated the work to local vigilance. I'm in a hurry, he said to the girl who now came up to his car. My name is Reginald Wako, Minister of Justice. So one of the girls approaches his car for a security check. Then he reveals his identity. Good afternoon, sir. I want to see your boot. Boot here does not refer to a footwear. It refers to a rear end of the car where there is sufficient space to keep the luggage. Oh, Christ, what do you think is in the boot? I don't know, sir. He got out of the car in suppressed rage, stalked to the back, opened the boot, and holding the lid up with his left hand, he motioned with the right as if to say, after you. So when this girl approached him while he was driving the car, he was stopped. The girl approached him and asked him to show the boot. Being helpless, he just moved out of the car and showed the boot, opened the boot, and through gestures, he said, okay, see, the boot is all yours. See, whatever, do whatever you want. Are you satisfied? He demanded. Yes, sir. Can I see your pigeonhole? Christ Almighty. He's very much frustrated. Why is that he being a senior most bureaucrat of Ministry of Justice? Why is he subjected to too many security checks? Sorry to delay you, sir, but you people gave us this job to do. So she is justifying her stance. She's saying, this is what you have asked us to do, and we are doing the same. Never mind, you're damn right. It's just that I happen to be in a hurry, but never mind. That's the glow box. Nothing there, as you can see. All right, sir, close it. Then she stopped the rear door and bent down to inspect under the seats. It was then he took the first real look at her, starting from behind. She was a beautiful girl in a breasty blue jersey, khaki jeans and canvas shoes with a new style hair plait, which gave a girl a defiant look and which they called, for reasons of their own, Air Force Base. And she looked vaguely familiar. So when she tries to have a look at the seat, that is when he actually have a look at this girl. He is very much impressed by the girl and he feels that this girl is familiar to him. I'm all right, sir, she said at the last, meaning she was through with her task. You don't recognize me? So then she asked, don't you recognize me? He says, no, should I? You gave me a lift to Enugu that time. I left my school to go and join the militia. So the girl only reminds him that we have met before. Okay, the first time when we met was you had dropped me to Enugu, where when she had left her school to join the militia or some organization. Yes, you were the girl. I told you, didn't I, to go back to school because girls were not required in the militia. What happened? So he also recollects. Okay, then say, I remember I dropped you. And at that time, I had suggested you not to join any militia. Why is that you are still in this? They told me to go back to school or join the Red Cross. Red Cross, you all know, is a kind of NGO or organization which deals with curing or which deals with medical aid of victims of war or any kind of strife. You see, I was right. So what are you doing now? Just patching up with civil defense. Civil defense, just like how we have home guards in India, or they are not, they are just, or they are aiding forces to the defense forces. Well, good luck to you. Believe me, you're a great girl. That was the day he finally believed there might be something in his talk about revolution. He had seen plenty of girls and women marching and demonstrating before now, but somehow he had never been able to give it much thought. He did not doubt that the girls and the women took themselves seriously. They obviously did, but so did the little kids who marched up and down the streets at the time, drilling with sticks and wearing their mother's soup bowls for steel helmets. The prime joke of the time among his friends was the contingent of girls from a local secondary school marching behind a banner, "We are impregnable." So he has a lot of misogynistic tones here. He recollects, he says, he tells that girl that, didn't I tell you that this militia is not suitable for girls? And he was not even surprised when a lot of women and girls were volunteering themselves for this fight. Okay, and they even made fun of, even brings in instances where other African men and other men made fun of African women being part of the struggle and about the slogan also. That is, or the banner, "We are impregnable," means you can't easily impregnate us, means we are more manly. But after that encounter at the Afghan checkpoint, he simply could not sneer at the girls again or at the talk of revolution, for he had seen it in the action in that young woman whose devotion had simply and without self-righteousness convicted himself of gross levity. What were her words? "We are doing the work you asked us to do." So look at this. He is very much frustrated about the adamance of that girl because she says, "This is the work that you gave it to us and we are doing it. Why are you bothered?" So he was not that much impressed by her. She wasn't going to make an exception even for one who once did her a favor. He was really shocked because on the one hand, he is a senior-most bureaucrat of the Ministry of Justice. On the other hand, beyond that, he had helped her prior. So he wondered, how can this girl be so rude and so much rule-minded because she is not even exempting me for helping her earlier. He was sure she would have searched her own father just as rigorously. With their paths crossed the third time. So the third time, first time, see, this is the third time they are meeting. First time, both of them met when the bureaucrat dropped her to one place. Second time, when this is punctured, or when this girl asks him to stop for a security check. When their paths crossed the third time, at least 18 months later, things had got very bad. Death and starvation, having long chased out the hedonists of the early days, now left in some places blank resignation, in others a rock-like, even suicidal defense. But surprisingly enough, there were many at this time who had no other desire than to corner whatever good things were still going and to enjoy themselves to the limit. See, the first and second time, there wasn't much of a problematic situation. In the third time, when both of them met, the situation had worsened. Okay, they had met near the place where they came to gather for food or food materials for the family members. But surprisingly enough, there were many at this time who had no other desire than to corner whatever good things were still going and to enjoy themselves to the limit. For such people, a strange normalcy had returned to the world. All those nervous checkpoints disappeared. Girls became girls once more and boys. It was a tight blockaded and desperate world, but nonetheless a world with some goodness and some badness and plenty of heroism, which however happened most times far, far below the eye level of people in this story, in out of the way refugee camps, in the damn tatters, in the hungry and barehanded courage of the first line of fire. So now all of them in this African country are fighting for food. So they are no more fighting for other aspects of rights. Their main focus is on food. Reginald Wanko lived in Oweri then, but that day he had gone to Kweri in search of relief. Relief, he himself being part of the bureaucracy, he himself could not get sufficient food. So he is only visiting the relief camp. He had got from Caritas in Overy a few heads of stockfish, some tinned meat and dreadful American stuff called Formula 2, which he felt certain was some kind of animal feed. So they didn't even leave animal feed. So he took it for human consumption. Such was the pathetic situation due to strife there. But he always had a vague suspicion that not being a Catholic put one at a disadvantage with Caritas. So he went now to see an old friend who ran the WCC depot Quarry to get other items like rice, beans, and that excellent cereal commonly called Gabon Gari. So Gabon Gari's name, you should make a note. This is the cereal that is mentioned as excellent. He left Overy at 6 in the morning so as to catch his friend at the depot, where he was known never to linger beyond 8:30 for fear of air raids. Quaco was very fortunate that day. The depot had received on the previous day large supplies of new stock as a result of an unusual number of plane landings a few nights earlier. So this particular depot used to close early by 8:30 because they had, if people gather near that depot, there could be airstrikes by the enemy. So under Quaco, this bureaucrat was lucky enough because Reginald was lucky enough because just before the previous day, the depot had received a lot of relief materials. As his driver loaded tins and bags and contents into his car, the starved crowds that perpetually hung around relief centers made crude, ungracious remarks like, "War can continue," meaning WCC. Somebody else shouted, "Irovalu," and his friends replied, "Shum." Irovalu Shum, Isopheli Shum, Isopheli Ba. So these are all protest voices by other people who are waiting near the relief camps. They are protesting against the depot manager because he is giving the relief materials to the person, to this bureaucrat who has come by the vehicle, and denying them the relief materials. Quanco was deeply embarrassed not by the jeers of the scarecrow crowd of racks and floating ribs, but by the independent accusation of their wasted bodies and sunken eyes. So Quanco also felt very much helpless, okay, and embarrassed because he is carrying carrying the required relief materials, denying that opportunity to those people who are hungry. Indeed, he would probably have felt much worse had they said nothing, simply looked on in silence as his boot was loaded with milk and powdered egg and oats and tinned meat and stockfish. So these are the equipments, these are the materials that he carried in his car boot. By nature, such singular good fortune in the midst of general desolation was certain to embarrass him. But what could a man do? He had a wife and 4 children living in the remote village of Obu and completely dependent on what relief he could find and send them. He was also helpless because he also has his wife and 4 children to take care of. He can't distribute that to other people. He could not abandon them to Kwashiorkar. Kwashiorkar is the name of a disease. The best he could do and did do, as a matter of fact, was to make sure that whenever he got sizable supplies like now, he made over some of it to his driver, Johnson, with a wife and 6, or was it 7? So he not only took care of his own family, also took care of the family of his driver. Children and salary of 10 pounds a month when Gari in the market was climbing to 1 pound per cigarette cup. In such a situation, one could do nothing at all for crowds. At best, one could try to be of some use to one's immediate neighbors, that was all. So the situation itself was pathetic, where the prices were skyrocketing. He had no other option. On his way back to Overy, a very attractive girl by the roadside waved for a lift. He ordered the driver to stop. Scores of pedestrians, dusty and exhausted, some military, some civil, swooped down on the car from all directions. So the moment he stopped to help a girl, people who were walking nearby thronged to his car, asking him for a lift. "No, no," said Quanco firmly. "It's the young woman I stopped for. I have a bad tire and can only take one person. Sorry." "My son, please," cried one old woman in despair, gripping the door handle. Old woman. So this old woman also requested, "Just accommodate me also in the car because I can't walk far." So then he said, "Old woman, you want to be killed?" shouted the driver as he pulled away, shaking her off. Quanco had already opened a book and sunk his eyes there for at least a mile. After that, he did not even look at the girl until she finding, perhaps, the silence too heavy, said, "You have saved me today. Thank you." So he did not bother to talk to the girl to whom he offered the lift. However, he was expecting gratitude from that girl. And finally, the girl expresses gratitude by saying, "Thank you." "Not at all. Where are you going?" "To Overy. You don't recognize me?" "Oh, yes, of course. What a fool I am. You are Gladys." So again, this is the girl whom he had met twice before. One was when he dropped her from a school to another place where she wanted to join the militia. Second was the girl only stopped him for security check. And this is the third time that his meeting her. That's all right, the militia girl. You have changed, Gladys. You are always beautiful, of course, but now you are a beauty queen. What do you do these days? I'm in the fuel directorate. That's wonderful. It was wonderful, he thought, but even more, it was tragic. She wore a high tinted wig and very expensive skirt and low cut blouse. Her shoes, obviously from Gabin, must have cost a fortune. In short, though Quanko thought she had to be in the keep of some well-placed gentleman, one of those piling up money out of the war. So looking at the beauty of this girl, he felt this girl should be married off or should be taken care by some rich man, even in this warlike situation, who can earn money even in warlike situation. I broke my rule today to give you a lift. I never give lifts these days. Why? How many people can you carry? Is it better not to try at all? Look at the old woman. I thought you would carry her. So now this girl is questioning, why is that you did not help the old woman who pleaded you? He said nothing to that. And after another spell of silence, Gladys thought maybe he was offended and so added, thank you for breaking your rule for me. She was scanning his face, turned slightly away. He smiled, turned and tapped her on the lap. What are you going to Overy to do? I'm going to visit my girlfriend. Girlfriend, you sure? Why not? If you drop me at her house, you can see her. Only I pray God she hasn't gone on weekend today. It will be serious. Why? Because if she is not at home, I will sleep at the road today. I pray to God that she is not at home. Why? Because if she's not at home, I will offer you a bed and breakfast. What is that? He asked the driver. You had brought the car to an abrupt stop. There was no need for answer. The small crowd ahead was looking upwards. The three scrambled out of a car and stumbled for the bush next, twisted in a backward search of the sky. But the alarm was false. The sky was silent and clear except for two high-flying vultures. A humorist in the crowd called them fighter and bomber, and everyone laughed in relief. The three climbed into their car again and continued their journey. It is much too early for rain. So here, this is a description of what happened in the story. So he says, now that girl asks, where are you going? When they met the third time, the girl asks, where are you going? When this girl, again, the second time he is offering the lift to her. Then he says, I'm going to meet my girlfriend. Okay. Then, and he says that if she's not at home, it will be very difficult as he'll be forced to sleep outside. Then there was an alarm, but which later turned out to be...
Your voice is lagging, sir.
Can you hear me properly?
Yes, sir. Yes.
There was an alarm related to the bombing, but later they found that it was false. The sky was silent and clear except for two high-flying vultures. Vultures you find only when there are dead bodies. So you could easily identify symbolically that there were some people were killed in this strike. The humorist in the crowd called them fighter and bomber. So addressing to these vultures. And everyone laughed in relief. The three climbed into their car again and continued their journey. It is much too early for raids, he said to Gladys, who had both her palms on her breast as though still a thumping heart. They rarely come before 10 o'clock. But she remained tongue-tied for her recent fright. Quanko saw an opportunity there and took it at once. Where does your friend live? 250 Douglas Road. Ah, that's the very center of town, a terrible place. No bunkers, nothing. I won't advise you to go there before 6 p.m. It's not safe. If you don't mind, I will take you to my place where there is good bunker. And then as soon as it's safe, around 6, I shall drive you to your friend. How's that? So here, this lady, Gladys, actually intends to visit her friend. But this Reginald insists not to go there before 6 p.m. Because this bombing and other things usually takes place during daytime. And it's unwritten ethical decision by across all military groups that one should not bomb after sunset. One should not fight after sunset. Then he tries to convince her. He says you can come to my room and use my bunker. There is a safe bunker there. And after sunset, you can go and visit your friend. We'll be all right. We are used to it. But your family is not there with you. No, he said. Nobody has his family there. We like to say it because of the air raids, but I can assure you there is more to it. Overy is a real swinging town and we live the life of gay bachelors. That is what I have heard. You will not just hear it, you will see it today. I shall take you to a real swinging party. A friend of mine, a lieutenant colonel, is having a birthday party. He has hired the Sound Smashers to play. I'm sure you'll enjoy it. He was immediately and thoroughly ashamed of himself. He hated the parties and frivolities to which his friends clung like drowning men. And to talk so approvingly of them because he wanted to take a girl home. And this particular girl too, who had once had such beautiful faith in the struggle and was betrayed, no doubt about it, by some man like him out for a good time. He shook his head sadly. So Reginald was not a kind of party person. Though he did not like going for parties, not to impress her, not to take Gladys to his home. He says, okay, let's go to a party. So till the time you can be at my home. What is it? Asked Gladys. Nothing, just my thoughts. They made the rest of the journey to a very practically in silence. So they did not talk much. She made herself at home very quickly as if she was a regular girlfriend of his. She changed into a house dress and put away her auburn wig. That is a lovely hairdo. Why did you hide it with a wig? So she also felt very comfortable in this house and even changed her dress. Thank you, she said, leaving his question unanswered for a while. Then she said, men are funny. So he talks about her hairdo. She removes her wig. And at that time, this person, Reginald, talks about her new hairstyle. Why do you say that? You are now a beauty queen, she mimicked. Oh, that, I mean every word of it. He pulled her to him and kissed her. She neither refused nor yielded fully, which he liked for a start. Too many girls were simply too easy those days. War sickness, some called it. So he advanced, he expressed his love towards her. She neither refused nor accepted fully. So it was considered a kind of war sickness because people were wanting for love. That's why they called this kind of a war sickness. He drove off a little later to look in at the office, and she busied herself in the kitchen helping his boy with lunch. It must have been literally a look-in, for he was back with half an hour, rubbing his hands and saying he could not stay away too long from his beauty queen. So he was, both of them were focusing on their household chores, but he immediately stopped and came back to Gladys, saying that I can't be far away for more duration from away from this beauty queen, he says. Okay, we'll stop at this. And the pending, we'll start.